Thanks to Dr. Ganesh Abbas for this invitation, and I was thinking with him before that maybe Italian and Egyptian people share the same blood. And I think that the continuous development of more efficacy and effective therapeutic approach for treating or in some issues instances curing several forms of atrial fibrillation has followed a complex path of the last 20-25 years throughout the different techniques that have been proposed and applied. You know that the incidence and prevalence is very high, and I think that this number continues to grow up over the time. You know that atrial fibrillation can affect a lot of the situation, and the question, do we know our target? Targets are a lot, because atrial fibrillation affects our quality of life. In patients with a very high rate can create a cardiomyopathy with progressive left ventricular dysfunction and heart failure. Of course, affect the heart failure hospitalization, but the most important point are that atrial fibrillation increases the risk of a stroke and death. We will find domains of integrated atrial fibrillation management and what we can do when we have patients with atrial fibrillation, which one should be our correct approach. I think that the guideline over the time changed their approach concerning atrial fibrillation ablation and anti-arrhythmic drugs, because in the evidence of European Society of Cardiology in 2012, atrial fibrillation ablation was reputed as a choice of patients when previous anti-arrhythmic drugs doesn't work. The situation changed 3 years later in 2004 because catheter ablation and anti-arrhythmic drugs, maybe they were to the same level in the flowchart of patients with and without structural heart disease. Well, you know that my point of view is that why anti-arrhythmic drugs doesn't work in atrial fibrillation, and especially in the mid and long-term follow-up. We have a lot of several randomized trials that have compared both rate and rhythm control using different anti-arrhythmic drugs, especially anodorone, but also class 1 and class 1A and 1C of classification of anti-arrhythmic drugs, compared with rate control with or without ablating pace, but also in patients that we are candidated for rhythm control, we adjunctive use both not only the anti-arrhythmic drugs but also several cardioversion. But the results of this several randomized study have demonstrated that the mortality doesn't change. Maybe it's better in the rate control in comparison with the rhythm control. The problem is that anti-arrhythmic drugs in a lot of patients, the benefit were antagonized by the adverse effect of anti-arrhythmic drugs in terms of hospitalization and the side effect. And amiodarone, that is what that is the most useful, because it's able to maintain in 1 year follow-up of that 42% sinus rhythm, sometimes it should be eliminated for side effect that can reach 25% in the population. The original film study deponed that the first consideration they conclude that there was no difference between rate and rhythm control about a lot of variables. The problem is the drawback of the anti-arrhythmic drugs, because many side effects that can develop over the time. These studies but do not conclude that the rate control is better than the rhythm control, but the anti-arrhythmic drug strategy applied for the rate control doesn't work. The global efficacy, that is 40-50% in several casuistics, is reduced over the time, because anti-arrhythmic drugs are not able to prevent the recurrence. And in an elevated percentage of patients, we should stop for inefficacy or for adverse or side effect. When we compare rate control with rhythm control, also the rate control, what does it mean? Untreated AFib often produce a poor exercise tolerance that improve when therapy starts. But we don't know which one should be the best heart rate, because the same patients, without a change in activity level, can demonstrate both symptomatic tachycardia and bradycardia. The big problem is the irregularity of the heart rate that has a negative consequence. And in my opinion, all the such target of heart rate that we apply are totally arbitrary. We should consider that also the elevated percentage of patients with atrial fibrillation are old, much more than 70% in much more 70 years of age. And even if the old patients are different one from each other, we should consider it that the effect on the channel, receptor, pump, and clinical effect of all the antiretinal drugs can have some problem in the old patients, because a lot of them have an altered liver or renal function. They can have electrolyte abnormality, interaction with the pharmacology, with the poor compliance. And in a little percentage of them, we can have also, sometimes also, a sick sinus syndrome. But the same investigator that conclude that retinal control doesn't work, or that there is the same effect, they underline one year later that the presence of a sinus rhythm was associated with a lower risk of death, and the use of antiretinal drugs was associated with an increased mortality. And if we can use some other approach, maybe it would be better. Since Dr. Isaguer and colleague first discovered the focal firing or spontaneous depolarization starting from the pulmonary vein, we develop a lot of techniques for understand what's going on inside the vitreous. Pulmonary vein are very interesting because we have two topics. The first one is that during atrial fibrillation we have a lot of fractionated electrogram with a slow conduction and with an heterogeneous repolarization that represent the ideal substrate for the reentry mechanism. And we can have also an adjunctive intense periodic electrical activity that can create a stable macro reentry around the junction. We know that trigger substrate is important, and trigger too, and maybe both mechanisms are involved in the determinism of atrial fibrillation, as well as the vagal ganglia that maybe can affect the autonomic innervation of the activity of atrial fibrillation. You know that defined the dominant role played, especially in the first phase of atrial fibrillation and paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, the next step was to limit the interaction between the vein and the remaining atrial tissue. We start several years ago. Now I am an old man gray, but when I start, I have all my dark hair, and maybe 20 years ago with Dr. Papone. And we started to compartmentalize and exclude the interaction between the vein and the remaining atrium. We developed our first system that was a circular defective mapping catheter that we put at the junction between the vein and the atrium, and using radio frequency energy, we try to disconnect the interaction between the veins and the atrium. We have a lot of clinical evidence that during ablation we can start and interrupt atrial fibrillation during the liver and the radio frequency energy, and we learn a lot. We know that the energy that we apply has a resective effect in the contact between the endocarcinoma, but the effect and disconnection that we can have over the time is related to the conductive heating of the tissue. And we learn a lot, because when we start, we use a very rudimental catheter, 4 millimeter, 8 millimeter. And another problem was that using the only fluoroscopy have a poor resolution between the tip of the catheter and the tissue. But I think that the big innovation was the creation of the virtual geometry, the three-dimensional mapping system. And we were pioneer, because in 2002 we published this first publication on circulation, and we demonstrated that the encircling of the pulmonary vein was efficacious and effective in patients with paroxysmal atrial fibrillation in a short medium follow-up, 1 year. When virtual geometry and three-dimensional mapping system was introduced in the common clinical setting, there was a lot of not all people was agree, because a lot of them that it is a tool or a toy in the hand of the electrophysiologist. We gain a lot of experience, and would like to show you that using a searching database that including PubMed and Base, Web of Science, Cochrane, and the systematic review, we select 19 reference studies that were able to demonstrate it, that especially in the first phase of ablation of atrial fibrillation, so 15 years ago, the single procedure wasn't very good enough. I mean, in some patients we should repeat the procedure for obtain a good success over the time. The big problem was that the first challenge is that the pulmonary vein anatomy could be very changeable. We can have some common trunk, we can have some adjuncting branch vein, and using the only electrosurgical approach, we are not able to understand very well. And the first topic is that we can disconnect the vein, but the first cause of recurrence was related to the incomplete pulmonary vein isolation. And this was very clear because we published with Dr. Cappato 1 year later that the prospective assessment of a late conduction recurrence across frequency, lesion, production, electrical disconnection could be improved over the time with the second or with the third step. So pulmonary vein is very important in determining for atrial fibrillation. Of course, using a new catheter, especially the coolly irrigated cultip catheter, during the procedure with a temperature control, we were much more able to disconnect the vein and improve so the efficacy and effective of the lesion over the time. We have now a lot of technique, irrigated cultip catheter, the multi-channel duty cycle, phase of the relative frequency energy for disconnecting the vein or the cryoballoon. And with the implemented use of a virtual geometry and 3D mapping system, we can ablate a patient and then we can remap in order to evaluate if we have performed a good disconnection of the vein. We use also the navigation system using the CartoSound, the ultrasound that emerges inside the 3D map for improve the definition of the anatomy of the atrium and of the, of course, the pulmonary vein. The left side is the first model when I start to ablate. The second one is a very beautiful model with a CT scan integrated inside to the CARTO system for a merge integration and for a very good and beautiful visualization of the pulmonary vein anatomy. Now I have also in my lab this integration. We integrated the fluoroscopy with the CARTO system. This is very good also because we can limit it a lot the X-ray exposure both for the physician and for the patient. But if you wanted to understand what's going on in a patient that we want to treat with anti-arrhythmic drugs or with the radiofrequency catheter ablation, there are a lot of differences in terms of success rate in a 1 year follow-up, 75% against 20%. I think that this paper is very beautiful because the results and the outcome were judged by an external reference committee. And in this multi-center prospecting randomized trial, we can see that the freedom from atrial fibrillation was totally different if you use catheter ablation or anti-arrhythmic drugs therapy. The global percentage of success using some meta-analysis in a lot of paper is 60% that improved to 70% if we perform some adjunctive procedure over the time. Catheter ablation is now a standard in the guideline in patients with symptomatic paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. And I think that anti-arrhythmic drugs could be very useful after the ablation because anti-arrhythmic drugs can limit the recurrence of the arrhythmia early and late, especially early, because you can see in this very beautiful study that we performed in the Hiroshi Nakagawa study in Oklahoma City, we can see that the wide range of the QRS, the conduction of the junction between the veins and the atrium change before and after the ablation. So anti-arrhythmic drugs maybe could be useful, and you can see in a very beautiful systematic literature and meta-analysis how the percentage of success rate with without anti-arrhythmic drugs after atrial fibrillation ablation improved. I think that the big topic of atrial fibrillation, which one, is that catheter ablation is associated with a reduction of risk stroke and mortality. This is a propensity score match analysis that is a test, an alpha discrete test, that is able to match different populations, homogenizing the results. And you can see that after matching, we can see that both the cumulative primary outcome, stroke and transient ischemic attack, was very low in patients with that were underwent to atrial fibrillation ablation. But also the secondary outcome, if you consider it independently, stroke, transient ischemic attack, or mortality, was reduced in patients with atrial fibrillation ablation. Even if the percentage of patients with the, in the ablation group that use oral anticoagulation and alternative drugs was lower in comparison with the non-ablation group. This is another study that demonstrated the same. And I would like to explain, I will speak with Dr. Gamal before, that we should sublate in the early phase of ablation, of atrial fibrillation, because over the time we can have some electrical, contractile, and structural remodeling. This is a visual cycle because atrial fibrillation creates a downregulation of L-type current calcium intake inside the cell. We have a reduction in duration of action potential. We have a reduction in wavelength so that more fibrillation will create more fibrillation than if it begets atrial fibrillation. But there is a very interesting consideration that electrical and contractile remodeling go hand in hand. If we have an atrial fibrillation, we have a dramatic reduction of the refractory period. But if we come back with conversion to sensory, we can come back to the situation of before. In the paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, we have that the number of wavelengths maybe is one or two. In the persistent atrial fibrillation, we have a lot of circuit of range inside the atrium. And we can have also a collagen deposition, expression of a tumor necrosis factor, apoptosis, and of course the connexin and gap junction, rearrange either connection so that the anisotropic conduction can perpetuate atrial fibrillation. But we should to intervene early, because structural remodeling is a slow process, but if we try to ablate late, the reversibility is slow and incomplete. We started to using some system for evaluate which one and with the percentage of fibrosis inside the atrium using the delay enhancement MRI. And according with the Utah stage, we can divide the fibrosis inside the atrium in 4 degrees. It's very important this because this is correlated with the percentage of a persistent or paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. It increases the persistent when we have a very large fibrosis inside the atrium. The virtual joint in three-dimensional mapping system, the CASO system, is very good for sensitive and specificity correlated with this CASO classification. And it's very important because these affect the results in patients with an extended fibrosis. Maybe it's not good enough to ablate these patients because the percentage of success rate was very low. We try to apply different technology, not only ablate the vein, but using the lines or fragment activity inside the atrium. But 2 years ago, I published on the New England Journal of Medicine with other colleagues this paper when we try to compare different approach, PVI, PVI plus lines, PVI plus cafe, and the winner is only PVI, because if we try to ablate some other substrate, we can increase only the complication during the procedure. So in conclusion, dear chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I think that the role of an early intervention is to prevent the structural remodeling, and we should consider the first episode seriously. Don't ablate when it's too late, and develop a reliable clinical tool is very important for understanding the diagnosis, but of course the subset of OAF. Thank you very much for your
thank you very much, and now the turn of the magic.